With me in the studio this afternoon, I've got Keith Allaun from PowerHouse Energy. Keith, really nice to have you back with us here in the studio.
It's been a while, Andrew, but we've been really busy, and I'm excited to be back.
You've been tremendously busy. Just let's work our way back through some of your recent announcements.
Sure.
Just this week, bringing in £900,000. Fair to say, quite a positive response here.
Oh, absolutely. You know, we as a board, we made the decision that what we needed to do for the benefit of our shareholders was to eliminate the 64 million share overhang that was hanging out there that people were concerned about was going to slowly be dripping its way back into the market every time there was any positive news, continuing to depress the share price for the next 2 years. In fact, our chairman had an experience similar to that at another company. And so we made the decision to simply place those shares out. Hmm. We had an agreement with Hillgrove that allowed us to do that. And so we took them off the table. We originally envisioned that we were going to just do a small fundraise, get Hillgrove out of the market and move forward. But the demand was so significant that we were frankly well oversubscribed. And so we ended up with £900,000, which positions us with wind in our sails, air at our back, and smooth sailing ahead, basically. So we're in a grand state financially, and we're looking forward to the completion of our engineering over the next 45 days, using those funds, and completion of permitting and planning, and really driving our commercial facilities forward aggressively. One of the other things that this money, the use of proceeds, is for is to start rolling out the SPVs that will allow us to ring fence every facility that we're going to be building. So we've come to the decision that philosophically we want to provide that ring fencing, one, because that eliminates dilution to our shareholders. It affords us the opportunity to bring in third-party investors into an SPV. The SPV will always be paying PowerHouse at least a 20% licensing fee. Owners of the SPV will be external third parties, interested parties, potential EPCs, as well as PowerHouse. And here in the UK, Wastetricity, as they're involved in the projects. So we feel like this SPV, the special purpose vehicle or special purpose company model, is one that is in the best interest of our shareholders, again, because it's wholly non-dilutive, it eliminates risk for them, and yet we've got a constant stream of income.
And Wastetricity alone, I think, they're targeting, 100 of these SPVs in the UK alone, plus more in Europe.
Well, they're targeting 100 units,
right,
in the UK, and they anticipate that those units will. It could be that two or three units are wrapped into a single SPV,
right?
But they have come out with the intent to deliver 100 of these what they're calling core DMG models, which is effectively distributed gasification, modular gasification that generates electricity only. Now those are all ready to generate hydrogen, but we're not building in that hydrogen component in these particular models because of where they are going to be co-located.
What kind of time frame do we know that they've put on these installations and the rollout?
They're looking at rolling those out over the next 3 to 4 years. So we're looking at a land grab here. The fact is that having our first commercial plant operational by the end of 2018 positions us for substantially easier financing. We've got people lining up saying, if you do this, we will do that, and they are ready to go. The money is not going to be a problem in rolling units 2 through 2,000 out. Money is not going to be a problem. And we're also starting to look at some relatively substantial grant money that is potentially coming into the company in a wholly non-dilutive manner, which again should excite our shareholders.
And I think, just working back to waste electricity for a moment.
Sure.
Something that hasn't been brought to too much attention, some of the numbers that they've put around this. I think what they've said, each installation could generate up to 900 thousand pounds in revenue on average per year. So taking into account your license fee, your royalties, a quick crunch of the numbers, somewhere are we talking between 18-20 million pounds alone through waste electricity here for Powerhouse?
And just for electricity.
And just for electricity.
So if we were to add hydrogen to that number, you'd be looking at a 4 to 5-fold increase in revenues. So all of a sudden you're looking at a FTSE 100 company in 4 to 5 years. So, and that is simply in the activities in which we're engaged here in the UK, exclusive of some things that we're about to talk about that we're going to be exploring in the EU.
Of course, but Australia also an interesting market for you?
Absolutely. Australia is facing the exact same crunch that the UK is facing in terms of China saying, sorry, we're not taking your waste anymore. We're not taking your waste plastics. We're not taking your recycling. We're not taking anything because we've got enough to deal with ourselves. You guys, good luck, Godspeed. And I've had calls from three Australian investors, major investors, this week alone. I have meetings set up next week with an Australian company and two meetings set up the following week with Australian companies, all of whom have projects up and ready to go to drive our technology as the solution for their issues in Australia. And all they're interested in is generating electricity at this juncture. They're paying 27 cents per kilowatt hour for electricity, which would be more than double what we're paying here in the UK for electricity. So the opportunities that exist there and that exist elsewhere in the Far East and in Japan, where we have a number of partners with whom we're talking, major transportation partners, for instance, whom I won't name at this juncture, that are extremely interested in this concept of distributed modular gasification in the generation of pure hydrogen energy.
Let's bring it back to Europe.
Okay.
Tresoil, tell me about this deal here.
Tresoil, yeah. We've been working with Roger Preston and Tresoil for a number of years in reality. And we finally came to an agreement. It was really the right time. It's the convergence of the right drivers. One of those drivers was the MOU that we recently signed with Wrightbus, right? Mm-hmm. And that MOU is moving aggressively into contract. Contracts are now with the lawyers for review, and we're going to have exclusive rights to represent Wrightbus in particular territories. And our intention is to be able to provide a turnkey solution. One of the challenges that cities have in saying, yes, I'll buy 35 hydrogen buses, is that they need to come up with a ton of hydrogen every day to power those 35 buses. Well, oddly enough, we can manufacture a ton of hydrogen every day. We can produce a ton of hydrogen every day. We can squeeze hydrogen out of their waste every single day and deliver it for their public transportation fleets. Coincidentally, one of the EU's major foci at this juncture is the decarbonization of the public transportation sector throughout Eastern Europe. Eastern Europe has some of the dirtiest air on the planet. And the EU is committed its finances, hundreds of millions of euros, to this decarbonization. And what does decarbonization mean? It means get rid of CO2, get rid of the particulate matter, get rid of the NOx and the SOx out of the out of that entire public transportation chain. The only thing that does that is hydrogen fuel, right? Hydrogen fuel cells are the only things that produce water vapor as the end of its power stream. Anything else is going to be creating CO2. Battery powered vehicles, unless they're powered they're charged by wind power or solar power, which only represents a fraction of the power that's out there, are simply moving that CO2 footprint from here and putting it over there. It's no longer at the tailpipe, but it's back at the power plant that's powering these things. So Tresoil has an 11-year track record of writing grants, acquiring grants. They've been involved in the acquisition of 130 million euros worth of grants in alternative energy over these past 11 years. They're an extremely knowledgeable and well-connected partner with very high-level connections throughout that sector of the EU. And that's where the EU itself is focusing, right? Poland, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria. These are four of their major focal points. They're taking these countries to court saying, you've got to do something about your air quality. Well, what they can do about their air quality is they can buy Wright bus hydrogen buses and receive a 200,000 euro rebate for every bus they buy, effectively making that bus the same price as a diesel bus. And if they use our hydrogen, they can purchase that hydrogen at a price that's equivalent to diesel. So there becomes zero financial issue and dozens of environmental issues that are solved through this process. So the idea of us being able to deliver these turnkey solutions into these environments is very exciting to us, as you can tell.
As I can tell indeed, Keith, massive opportunity. Look, a couple of other things I've got to run past you before I let you go. Talk to me about Bruce Nicholson.
Bruce Nicholson is such a tremendous asset to the company. So Bruce is joining us after a 25-year career in oil and gas, alternative energy, delivering energy projects over the course of his career worth billions of pounds. This guy has been at the forefront of project management of massive projects, business development activities, financial management of projects, risk management, risk control, and he is a tremendous asset. When you look at adding Bruce to the mix, that all of a sudden affords us true commercial robustness in our team, coupled with our true technical robustness with David Ryan, our technical director, and our CFO, Chris Vanessis, and then me as the CEO. Having brought Dr. Cameron Davies in as our chairman last October has freed me up to focus on my job, which is running this company, building this company, expanding upon the commercial opportunities. And having a partner like Bruce by my side allows us, it's not a 1+1=2, it's like a 1+1=3, because the guy's like the Energizer Bunny. You know, he's just going and going and going. And so we're extremely fortunate to have him on board, and people will have the opportunity to see and hear from Bruce over the next couple of months, I guarantee.
Just finally, Keith, you're at the UK Investor Show tomorrow. You're going to have a busy booth?
Yeah, I imagine we typically always have a busy booth. You know, the nice thing is that people are starting to recognize that hydrogen is the fuel of the future. Hydrogen is actually the fuel that fuels the sun, right? It's compressed solar power. It's like, you know, fresh squeezed hydrogen is what we produce. And so we're the only company that produces hydrogen from waste. And people are excited about ending the waste problem, eradicating plastics from the waste streams, turning that plastic into something that's worthwhile rather than just burning it, where you're losing 70% of its energy value and you're losing all of its hydrogen. Right. So instead of losing that stuff, allow us the opportunity to squeeze that hydrogen out of it through our process and deliver that as a clean, quality, carbon negative road fuel that makes a huge difference both in terms of the economics, the environment, and we're able to take the problem or the solution to where the problem lies. So we're yes, we expect to have a rather busy booth.
And speaking of squeezing, I think we're out of time.
Okay.
Really good to see you. Thanks very much.
As always, Andrew, thank you.